Do subscribe to Ekeeda channel and press bell icon to get updates about latest engineering, HSE and IIT JEE main and advanced videos.
Hello friends, in the last lecture we have did a lecture on compressibility factor, and from that we have got to know that if we reduce the volume of the particular gas, or if you say it at anyhow, suppose if the volume of the gas gets reduced, so there is the possibility that there will be increase in intermolecular force of attraction, and because of that liquefaction can take place. But on based on that theory only, we are now going to learn about what is Andrews isotherm for liquefaction of gas. So let us learn about it. So the Andrews isotherm for liquefaction of gas, it means that the liquefaction of gas can be explained with the help of Andrews isotherm. So Andrews isotherm is nothing but a graph. It is a graph which is related to at constant temperature and the pressure and volume, which varies. So obtained by plotting pressure and volume isotherm for carbon dioxide at constant temperature. So isotherm itself suggests that we have to take the overall study, we have to study for a particular gas at constant temperature and varying or changing the value of pressure and volume. So overall the temperature should be constant, and on based on that thing we have to basically compress or we have to liquefy a particular gas. So based on that only, let me explain you the isotherm of carbon dioxide. So for that I have drawn a graph which clearly indicates that it is a graph which is related to pressure and volume, and the temperature has been kept constant. So let me give you an example of that how the temperature are been kept constant in this case. So suppose the pressure and volume in this case, they will vary or they will change. In this case the volume will increase, and in this case the pressure will go on increasing. But as we could see that we can see many curves in this graph. So each curve is being kept with a constant temperature. For example, if I am talking about the curve like A, B, C and D. So this blue line, as you could see, it has been maintained or it has been studied under the temperature of 13.1 degree Celsius. So even though if we'll get this kind of graph, so this kind of graph will only obtain at 13.1 degree Celsius. So in this case the temperature has been kept constant, or just eliminate everything and just focus on this thing. So in this case 13.1 is the temperature that we are keeping constant. So therefore this is an isotherm of that. So now talking about the next one, that is 21.5 degrees Celsius. Again, this is a temperature which has been kept constant, and on that constant temperature and by varying pressure and volume, we'll get this kind of curve which is above the curve of A, B, C and D. And further 31.1 and 32.5, 35.5 and 48.1 degrees Celsius. These are the graphs that we are obtained at a particular constant temperature. So this is what the isotherm is. So but let me tell you a few analysis or few points which is based on this isotherm, is that we could see there are two kinds of graph or two kinds of isothermals that we get. That is, above 31.1 degree Celsius, the isothermals are almost rectangular hyperbola resembling the behavior of a perfect gas. While the one which is below 31.1 degrees Celsius, the isothermals are not rectangular hyperbola. So in this case, we get two kinds of isothermals. So again, coming back to the graph. So this is the 31.1 degree Celsius. This is the isotherm that we get at 31.1 degree Celsius. In this case, we get two kinds of isothermals. That is, the one which is above 31.1 and the one which is below 31.1. And in this case, we could see the rectangular hyperbolas, while above we cannot see the rectangular hyperbolas. So now talking about the first curve, or talking about the first isothermal, that is the isothermal that is of 13.1 degree Celsius. At 13.1 degree Celsius, this is the point that we are going to mention about. So in this case what happens is, suppose if a gas has a particular volume and at that is 13.1 degree Celsius, that is at A suppose, and what I am doing is, if I increase the pressure, So what will happen? The volume will go on decreasing. So therefore, as you could see that if I increase the pressure in this side, the volume decreases and it decreases till point B. But the curve that I could see, that the curve is been elevating, that is, it has been elevating from A to B towards the pressure axis and above the volume axis. As you could see, this is going above the volume axis and towards the this pressure axis. So this is basically behaving like a Boyle's law, as we know that pressure and volume, the both are being inversely proportional to each other at constant temperature. So therefore this is behaving like a Boyle's law. But if we move further, that is, if we move that is from B to C, if we would see that is, even though if I increase the pressure, or suppose from this extent, that is from B till more, even though if I'm increasing the pressure, so what happens is the volume, it reduces. Okay, it will reduce and the pressure will remain constant in this case. So at this point, that is from B to C, the volume remains constant. The volume changes, that is from B to C, that it will go on decreasing, but in this case the pressure will remain constant. So even though if I increase the pressure, so the what will happen is the pressure in this case will remain constant and making the volume of that gas to decrease. And this is the because the gas which is present, that is the carbon dioxide, in this case it tries to condense, or basically it tries to liquefy. So the liquefaction basically starts from B, and even though if I increase the pressure, so what happens is the pressure will remain constant and the volume, it will get reduced. So at that point, that is at point B, the liquefaction starts. And because of which, what happens is the pressure in this case will remain constant, or will vary a very or will very small, or the change will be very small when the pressure has been increasing, or basically constant. So at point B, the condensation starts till point C, where overall gas of the carbon dioxide is been liquefied. And even though in that case, suppose if I increase the pressure, what happens is the volume in this case remains constant. So that means we cannot compress this gas more if we increase the pressure. So this was the isotherm that was I was talking about, the curve, that is A, B, C and D. Now talking about the next one, that is at 21 degree Celsius, 21.5 degree Celsius, it is the same curve that you will observe, that is from E to F, it will follow Boyle's law. And even though if I increase the pressure, what happens is the volume decreases. So from F to G, again the condensation takes place. So the pressure will remain constant throughout this case, or it will vary, or it will change a very little bit. And in this case, again the condensation takes place. And what happens is from F, the condensation, the liquefaction basically, it starts, and till G, the liquefaction gets completed. And even though if I increase the pressure, what happens is the pressure will remain basically, even though if I increase the pressure, the volume will remain constant. The volume will remain constant throughout this pressure as well as at this temperature. And talking about the next one, and this is the most crucial one that we are going to talk about, that is at 31.1 degree Celsius. So what do we observe? Again, from 31, that is from this point till point P, what happens is it will obey Boyle's law. But you could see that it is touching this dome, and this dome area, this is the dome area, and this is that dome area which has made us to understand that where the condensation starts and where it gets completed. So the curve like ABCD, where from at point B the condensation starts, and thus at point C the condensation, that is the liquefaction, gets completed. And what happens is, as we increase the pressure, or as we increase the temperature in this case, the dome area gets reduced, or basically the condensation equilibrium gets reduced. So at point P, what happens is the liquefaction starts. So It is not making a horizontal curve like GF, like BC, if you'll say. So from this point, suppose this point liquefaction starts, and this overall region, as you could see here, it has been liquid, while this region is basically gas. So basically this dome is been dividing two parts. That is, one is the gaseous state, while the other is the liquid state. And the region in the dome area is in equilibrium with the gaseous state and the liquid state. But the point P, it touches the dome area, the height of the dome area, which indicates that at point E, at point P, the liquefaction is been done completely. Starts as well, it completes at point P itself, while the other case at point B, the condensation starts again, it is following the equilibrium with the gas, liquid, gas, liquid, and again at point C it gets completed to the liquid. But at point P, if you would see, the liquefaction is been starting as well as it has been completing. So therefore this plays a very crucial point in the overall graph, and this indicates that 31.1 degrees Celsius is the critical temperature of carbon dioxide for the conversion of a gas of that is carbon dioxide to the liquid carbon dioxide. So in this case, 31.1 degrees Celsius is the critical temperature, and above which the carbon dioxide cannot be liquefied, yes, but it will be remain as the gas. So below which, that is 31.1, there is a possibility that we could convert the gaseous carbon dioxide to liquid carbon dioxide, or we could liquefy that. So this P is the most critical point, a very crucial point. That's the reason it is said to be, this temperature is said to be critical temperature, below which we could compress the gas, or we could make the gas to be converted into liquid, but above which we cannot be converted into liquid. So that's the reason I've indicated in three colors. So this ABC I have indicated in blue, EFGH I have indicated in green, while this crucial one I have indicated with the red line or red curve, if you will see. While the rest of the curve, that is at 32.5 degrees Celsius, 35.5 at 48.1. So these are basically obeying Boyle's law. And Boyle's law is just for gas. Okay, Boyle's law is for gas. It is, there is no concern in that case for liquefaction. So they all are behaving like a perfect gas, or if you could say that like an ideal gas. So the gas will remain, the gas will remain in the gaseous state only in this case, that is at 32.5 and 35.5 and 48.1. So we cannot reduce it to liquid. So this was the graph that I was talking about. So now let us see a conclusion that we have got to learn, that we have got to know while studying this graph, or while studying this isotherm. The first conclusion that we have got is the portion AB represents the gaseous phase of the substance, and BC represents the conversion from vapor to liquid state. So this is the thing. So this curve AB represents the gaseous state, because this is obeying Boyle's law, and the overall this region will be gas, because it is the only the dome which separates a gaseous state and a liquid state. So in this case, this region is liquid state, while this overall region will be in gaseous state. So therefore AB is present in gaseous state, while the BC is being representing the conversion of the vapor to the liquid state, that is of carbon dioxide. Now next, at B, conversion starts, and at C it gets completed. That is what I have talked about. So at B, conversion starts. It starts and it forms an equilibrium again, and it will become constant. It will give a constant pressure value. And at point C, the liquefaction gets completed. And after that, it will be present in liquid only. So at 13.1 degrees Celsius, it will liquefy at point C, it will reduce the volume, and unless it won't reduce the volume, and the overall pressure, if even though it will increase, the carbon dioxide will remain in the liquid state only. So now talking about the next one, that is, this was the first and the second conclusion that we have made, and talking about the third one, that is, at 21.5 degrees Celsius, the curve is similar, but only the horizontal portion BC has decreased. So what happens is, at 21.5 degrees Celsius, we get a horizontal curve, that is GF. But it has been less compared to that of the BC. As well as BC, if you would see this curve, that is this condensation curve, is basically lower than that of this FG curve. So this shows that compression produces liquefaction. So it is very prominent to know that this will indicate that the liquefaction will only occur if the compression, that is compression will happen or it will occur. So now the next one, that is at 31.1 degrees Celsius, the horizontal portion just disappears, which means the gas can be liquefied at that temperature. So this, that is 31.1 degrees Celsius, in which the gas can be liquefied. And as I have mentioned earlier, because we can't see any kind of horizontal curve while in this blue line or in this green curve, so this is only a point P. So it indicates that the gas starts easily getting liquefied at 31.1 degrees Celsius, which makes 31.1 degrees Celsius to be the critical temperature. So now moving at the last one, that is about this temperature, that is 32.5 degrees Celsius and 35.5 degrees Celsius and 48 or more than that, the behavior of the gas is that of a perfect gas. Because the perfect gas means that it will behave like a normal gas, and that normal gas at this temperature cannot be liquefied. So this is what the graph means that we are talking about. And the more important thing that it would be the overall comparison or overall observation of this graph is that we cannot compress, we cannot liquefy a particular gas just by pressurizing it. This is the thing that we have got to see, because in this case also, every time we have increased the pressure, so in this case the pressure will be the same. In this case, suppose if I'm talking about the curve at 48.1, the pressure is same. By talking about the curve at 35.5, again every curve and every pressure has been same of different curve, as we could see. And it is the most highest, suppose if it is the most highest, but not every curve gets it detailed that the gas has been liquefied. Only this curve, suppose if I am talking about these three curves, only this three curve have been started to convert it into a liquid form. Why? Because they have also a relationship with their temperatures. If you reduce the temperature, then shortly and at high pressure you will liquefy the particular gas. And if you increase the temperature, and if you start to increase the pressure, suppose if I am talking about 48.1 degrees Celsius, it is comparatively higher compared to that of 13.1. So at higher temperature, if you expect that only by pressure we could reduce the volume, or possibly if we are talking about, that is, we are reducing the volume, that means we are converting the gas into liquid, it is not possible, or it is not that for sure for a particular real gas. So that means it surely indicates that we should, along with pressure and volume, we should also change the temperature. If the temperature is less and we are providing high temperature, if the temperature is less and we are providing high pressure, then there is a possibility of conversion of a gas into liquid. So this is the main thing that we have got to learn now by using or by studying the Andrews isotherm. So I hope you have understand that how the pressure, volume as well as temperature plays a vital role in conversion of a gas to a liquid of that gas. So thank you friends for watching this video. I hope you have liked this video and you have understood this concept very clearly. And yes, don't forget to share this with the friends, and yes, don't forget to subscribe Ekeeda channel. Thank you so much.